sleeps like a monster under my bed. And fear dances round and round in my head. For every single time I thought I was dead, you were with me in the valley. You were with me. Oh, you're with me in the fire. You're strong and never tired. I can run at the giant. Oh, how can I deny it? I'm no longer hiding. I can run at the giant. And every doubt that I've had sits on my shoulder.
Bringing you stories of strength and hope. And we're here in Nashville, the capital, music capital of America. And I'm here with Jack Cassidy. Jack, thank you so much for spending your time here with us today.
So good to be with you.
Jack, this has been a little bit of a journey. I have to admit, when I heard your song, so it was sometime during COVID and we're in lockdown, and I heard Run at the Giant. And it was one of those where I heard the words and I was singing to them. Very catchy song. I loved the melody. And I had hit the like button, and I kept hearing the song come up over and over. And there was about a 15-second clip on Pandora, and it talked very briefly about your story. And I had never stopped to really think about what the words meant until I heard them. And when I did, I came unglued. And I had one of these cries that like took me to the ground. Huh. And I knew in that moment I needed to hear more. We needed to hear more about your story. Hmm. It's so powerful. And so thank you for using your platform to tell your story of it is strength and hope. So I'd love to hear. So here we are in Nashville. This has been months in the making. Jack, will you tell us about your story and how you got here today?
Yeah, I mean, one, praise God for that. That's amazing. And I do like to be an open, as much of an open book as I can, because I think God has put that mandate in my heart to just, yeah, he's given me a story, and he's brought me through a lot of different trials in my life. And if I can just be, you know, vulnerable about that in the position he's put me in, that's my message. I want to spread that hope to people. But yeah, my story kind of started back in Los Angeles. I grew up in a incredibly musically based family. I don't know if you know anything about it or not, but the Cassidy clan, it's like my uncles David and Shaun Cassidy, big teen pop stars. And so I grew up in that world, in that environment, which is different, you know. Fame type people get a little, you know, more treatment and more attention than other types of people. And however, my family did do a really good job of just like raising me right and teaching me what was really true about life, and keeping, you know, hold of God, hold of family, and not letting the craziness of fame, you know, get in your head. And but you know, that world of Los Angeles can be a wild roller coaster to ride.
Yeah.
And you know, growing up, I mean, my story is so founded on God and on Christ and how he saved me out of that. But I wasn't a believer my whole life. I was kind of more of an atheist agnostic up to my freshman year of high school. Then my mom sent me to a Christian camp when our family was actually struggling with kind of addiction stuff, and mm-hmm. she was like, I'm gonna send my sons here to hopefully, if they find Jesus, they can bring back some sort of hope into our house, because it was kind of crumbling at that time. Mm. And so I went up there and just encountered this radical message of love. And
when you were 14?
This was when I was, 14, 15.
Wow.
And without even knowing if God was real, I just kind of said yes to what I was hearing. I was like, if this is real, I want that. That's amazing. And so my prayer from there kind of became a prayer for evidence, like, Lord, I'll follow you, I'll do this stuff, but just give me the assurance that you're real, that I'm not going to waste my life pursuing something that's untrue. Mm-hmm. And I just got, over those next 2 years, just got flooded with those evidences. Mm. And just saw some wild supernatural stuff, and just saw the power, the true power of the name of Jesus, and what that could do in people's lives, and just so many evidences that mm-hmm. I just...
And this was in your family, within your friends, within...
Stuff like that, and also I did like some street ministry, and we'd go pray for, you know, people that were just crossed our paths, or homeless folks, and...
So you were really in the ministry out there.
Just met a good group of people that just had real hearts for that, and uh-huh. I just kind of followed them, and saw some amazing stuff. A lot of healings, a lot of demons casted out. You know, people believe that, but I've seen it firsthand.
Yeah.
And it's just pretty remarkable. And that's the good side, you know. And then even despite all of those things, and I was seeing really cool stuff, you know, personal problems get in the way. And mm-hmm. and I had already known Christ, and I had already, you know, seen those miraculous things, but somewhere along the line it was so I was on The Voice mm-hmm. right out of high school. Skipped the whole college thing mm-hmm. and just went right on a TV show.
Yeah.
And it was cool, that opportunity just really kind of fell in my lap amazingly, and just kind of walked through those doors. And
how was that? I imagine that's kind of intimidating. Is that the one where they turn around?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it's crazy intimidating. Yeah. For someone who really doesn't get nervous performing, it's like where I feel comfortable.
Yeah.
They really put you through, like, the grinder there.
Yeah.
Like, the day of that performance. I mean, you're preparing, like, a month beforehand for this big moment. You're working on this one song. You're just going over what it's going to be in your head. And then you just get on there, and the lights and the chairs, and you're just like, oh, if I blow this, I'm going to look like a fool on national television. But if I succeed, so when that first chair turns around, it's like the biggest relief in the world. And Adam, I can't remember, I was gonna say Adam Levine.
Yeah.
Turned around first, and then Alicia Keys, and I went with Alicia, and she was great. And
I think you have to have a strong heart for that, or a strong throat, because I think my throat would close up. I think in that
it was
moment.
And I was like, I had like a little cold that day, which even freaked me out more. I was like, oh, I'm not gonna be able to hit these high notes, and I did kind of crack on one of them, but they heard something that made them want to turn. So praise God
lots
for that.
Lots of respect.
Which is cool now, because like nothing ever feels difficult in terms of pressure.
You're like, I was on The Voice.
I experienced
I can do this.
The highest amount of pressure already.
Yeah.
But when I got voted off, you know, I was young. I was 18, and I didn't have a sure sense of my identity yet. And that kind of just, you know, and something I always kind of struggled with, even though I didn't really know what it was then, was just depression and hitting lows, and how that would manifest into just, you know, kill your self-esteem and just make you not want to do much or pursue much, and just oversleep and just... Mm-hmm. And then self-medicate in certain ways. Mm-hmm. So when I came off the high of that show, and then things just kind of like, I wasn't sure of myself. I let myself get kind of wrapped up in that world for a little mm-hmm. bit. And in that moment of weakness, I turned to drugs. And marijuana had always kind of been prevalent throughout high school a little bit. I didn't do it all, like, it was slow, it was progressive, but then that, it wasn't my thing, but it mm-hmm. definitely set me up for, that type of thinking, like, oh, drugs can help me mm-hmm. escape. Drugs can, when I'm feeling kind of squirrely and not cool with myself, I'll just do that, just trying to, you know, get out of it for a minute. And then I got introduced to cocaine one night at a party, and I was like, my family like raised me because, you know, that was prevalent in the world we were in, and mm-hmm. and you know, they had dealt with all of that and seen the repercussions of all that, so my parents kind of made me and my brother like aware of that early on, and we were just like, no, never mm-hmm. gonna touch that. And you know, things change and life takes over, and in that moment of weakness I just caved in mm. And started that whole animal, and then that picked up and took over pretty fast. Mm. I think my real addiction with that only lasted about a year and a half to 2 years, but within that time frame it completely messed me up.
And that was at 19?
That was that journey. I was at 19. Yeah. I mean, it got to I completely drained my bank account.
Yeah.
Nothing but negative signs in my bank account and credit card debt, and you know, separated me from my friends and family. I was not like a partier on that drug. I would isolate for yeah. hours at a time and you know, leave home and just be in my car and do it in my car just to try to get away. Just a full-blown addiction, and would put all my time into it, all my money and efforts into it.
Did anyone have any idea?
Not in the beginning, for yeah. some reason. Because at that time I was kind of quiet anyway.
Yeah.
You know, in times I would isolate, it was just like, oh, Jack's being quiet, or Jack's mm-hmm. just going into one of those places. But then over time it kind of became more evident. And mm-hmm. I forgot how my parents found out. I actually might have told them one time, in like a moment where I was kind of sober. You know, mm-hmm. in the beginning, it would be like a month on, a month off.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I might have shared it with them, so which like, you know, just made them a little more aware.
Yeah.
And looked out for signs, and then they picked up on it.
Were you scared to talk about it?
In the midst of it, yeah. I mean, yeah, I wouldn't say I'd let people in on it, but people would pick up on it. My close friends, if I was hanging around them and, you know, less shy about being high around them, they would definitely see it and then see that I was not being myself and I was just mm-hmm. changing. I feel bad about what I put my friends through. Didn't do anything like crazy personally offensive to them, but just would definitely manipulate and use them in some ways, because mm-hmm. that's how addicts behave when they're in the midst of it. And it got to the point by the end of it where I was just doing it all the time, every day, and that drug is such a stimulant that, you know, you can't sleep on it.
Yeah. How was your relationship with Christ at this time? Was it existent?
It was buried. It was buried deep down.
Yeah.
I didn't lose faith. You know, I didn't lose my Christianity. I still thought, you know, Jesus is Lord, but
yeah.
But I have no idea what that looks like right now in my life, because I'm just fully caught up in this yeah. different terrible type of thing.
So the relationship.
The relationship wasn't there. Was severed. Yeah.
Yeah.
Not on God's part.
Yeah.
He was always calling, but I was.
Yeah.
I was turning my back, and not that I wanted to. It was just specifically the depression and the lack of identity, and then just, you know, the way my brain thinks as an addict is just took over, and didn't just sever my relationship with God, but my friends, my family, everything. It was just. And I got kicked out of a few houses and had to, you know, couch hop, and even disrespected the people I was couch hopping, because
yeah.
you just don't care. You're selfish and you just want what you want in that place.
Yeah. So there was a moment in your life, maybe there were a few moments, but there was a moment in your life where you said, where you made a commitment to yourself. Talk about that commitment when you decided to, that you didn't want to go down this path any longer. What did that look like?
Typically, it's when you hit your rock bottom. People that can get out of it before that, you know, praise God. But for me, I had to have a very close experience with death before I really woke up and cried out. But yeah, it was one night in Santa Monica after I'd gotten kicked out of my parents' house and was living with staying at a friend's little apartment. And throughout those 4 days, I was using the whole time, and you know, no sleep for 4 days, it messes you up. Mm-hmm. That already puts you on like a death brink.
Yeah.
Just that itself, and then just continuing to use. And my highs were really high, and my lows were really low. When I'd come down, it was really bad. So it just makes you want to keep using to get back up. And this was like a different dealer I had at that time, because I was in Santa Monica now, so I sought out, you know, something, and it's pretty easy to find in Santa Monica. Mm-hmm. On that fourth day, when I was just, you know, tweaking out and all that, I did another line, and it was too much. And I was in the midst of, I call it a full-blown overdose, you know. You don't have to necessarily die to have an overdose. It's when you take too much that your body literally can't handle it. Mm. And that's what happened. And then I felt my whole body just start to go cold and numb. And I had a full-blown anxiety attack. And my heart started racing out of my chest. And I was like, uh-oh. And I freaked out. And I was like, I'm about to die.
Did your friend know?
No, he knew afterward, because I like trashed his apartment. I was alone at this time. And there was no service on my phone, couldn't call anyone at that time. And so I just, I hit my knees and cried out to the one that I knew could save, but I turned my back on for a while. Mm. And
do you remember that?
Oh, clearly. Yeah. Cried out to Jesus in such a vulnerable and maybe even selfish place. Like, I've been doing this so long, and I don't deserve to be saved right now. But if you're willing, like, you're the only chance I got.
Mm.
And his grace and his love completely broke through. And
did you feel it?
Like, you couldn't imagine. Yeah.
What did it feel like?
It felt like the Spirit of God just gave me a hug in that moment, and I felt peace just completely overwhelm me from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
In the midst of my body still, like, I was coming down at this point, and he just walked me through that whole night. And I have a song called Song of Victory that's probably going to be my next single, which I'm really excited about. But the first line of that song is, there's a song that's playing louder than the chaos.
Mm.
And Jesus is that song. And he was literally like standing with me in the fire. It wasn't like he just took the fire away. He just said, I'm gonna come in and show you that I'm stronger than this. And I'm going to walk you through that. So I just stayed in that place the whole night. In the midst of the come down, and I truly believe if I couldn't access that place, if he didn't give me that ability, it would have just taken over, and the anxiety would have killed me.
Mm-hmm.
And probably given me a heart attack at that point. And he saved my life that night. And
talk about the words of your song. So, Run at the Giant. You talk about how you face your Goliath. Run at the Giant, and God being at your song, God being at your side.
Yeah.
Talk about this song and what this means to you and your story, and some of the words that really touch you. The whole song, I will tell you, brings me to tears. So I will tell you that much. Talk a little bit about the song.
Yeah. That song's kind of, it was kind of that, yeah, throughout the addiction, how God was still with me then, but it was specifically in that moment where I realized that he was still with me. It's when I turned my face again, and then he just came really close. And it was from that point, I was like, okay. You know, I still had to get through that, and once I got clear-headed the next few days, it was like, okay, that just happened. That was amazing. That was a miracle, but there's still steps that I got to do now to, like, not let this happen again.
Yeah.
But I definitely saw it from a new perspective at that time. It was, you know, I was like, yeah, cocaine's going to lead to death.
Yeah.
And if I follow this Jesus path, it's gonna probably lead me out of it.
Had you tried anything before, any programs or anything to get sober at that point?
I hadn't yet.
Other than maybe white knuckling it for a bit and hoping that worked?
I did once, and I'll get to that in a minute, but not before that time. Yeah, it was like, okay, I recognized what cocaine was first. It was not my friend. It was not this thing that was going to help me get out of my problems. It was magnifying them.
Yeah.
So if you can expose that as the giant, mm-hmm. then you can see what it is. And now this is something I have to overcome. And the whole point of that song is that based on what God showed me that night, that he was stronger in that moment, even when, you know, the giant was manifesting as big as it could have been and scaring me and terrifying me in that moment, God said, no, I'm bigger than this, and mm-hmm. I'm going to stand with you even in this moment of your weakest, lowest place.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're going to climb out of that. So it was based on, because I have Christ, because of just who he is, the love, life, peace, and beauty of who he is in our lives, and we allow him to, you know, to be that in us. It was because I have God, because I can do that, because he's with me in those mm-hmm. fires, because he's the one that'll never, you know, tire, which is one of the lyrics. Yeah. And even when my strength is weak, and or there's a temptation or there's a draw to go do that again, I can see it for what it is and say no, and I can just, you know, surrender and keep my eyes fixed here, and then all of a sudden that giant is not as big as you think it is.
Mm.
And because God is just way bigger. So.
Mm. It's so powerful. And I know that resonates with so many in recovery. And I think for all of us, regardless of what the higher power is, there's a higher power in our lives. And when we let go, let God, which is your most recent single that came out, and how our lives can change. It's incredible. Talk about let go, let God. I think within the first month there were 500,000 downloads on YouTube or so. I mean, I'm so blown away at just the message that you're bringing out to the world, and it's just it's on fire. Talk about let go, let God, and what that means.
Yeah, thank you first of all. But it's more simple than Run at the Giant. It's a universal message.
Yeah.
I always say the message is the title, to let go and let God. But mm-hmm. I always say when our heart can understand just a simple truth, like it doesn't have to be complicated, just like, yeah, I should, I don't have it all together. I should let go of these things that are taking me down, those things that are leading me to those addictions. You know, drugs isn't the main problem. That's just the symptom of the problem. It's mm-hmm. it's what's going on in here. Mm-hmm. What's not making you be at peace with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I just in my experience, when you bring those things at the foot of the cross and just give those up to the Lord, he has an amazing job of just taking those away, and he lets us, you know, walk into the person that we're really supposed to be, that we were created to be, instead of getting lost in this other world because of the things that press us in life. So if you can just stay in that place at all times and just let go of the things that you can't control and just give them up to a higher power that knows better and knows best, it's going to work out to make us, you know, who we're supposed to be
every time. Who is Jack Cassidy?
Jack Cassidy is I'm a kind guy that really loves people and really has a desire to see people experience the freedom and the love that I've experienced. And I love to share that through, you know, the gift of music that God's put inside of me. Mm. I love music, but I chose to be a Christian artist because I know there's such power in music and there's such power in the gospel, and when you combine those things, and based on the anointing that God's put inside of me, I've seen people just, you know, I've seen lives change just based on, you know, songs that I can sing that I can really dive deep down into what I'm going through and share that with others. It's amazing the fruit and the hope that comes from that.
Absolutely. You had me on my knees. I was crying.
Amen.
It's an amazing, it's a beautiful talent that you have. Have you always aspired to be a singer, or did that come out of this journey?
Yeah, it wasn't so obvious. It was, I mean, I grew up singing my whole life. Uh-huh. And there was one night when I was in the car with my parents and Jesus Take the Wheel by Carrie Underwood was on, and I just kind of got, I was kind of shy back then and quiet, but then I was just kind of getting lost in the song and just...
You can't get lost in that song. Yeah. That's a bold song.
It's a bold song. And at that end, with that big high note, I just kind of belted it out.
Yes.
And my dad slams on the brakes and looks back and says, "What the hell was that?" And he was like, "From now on, you're singing all the time." So he recognized something that was just different. That was just really good.
Yeah.
And just started to cultivate that. And where was I going with that? Yeah. And so that led me to I didn't know that music was going to be the thing. Like, I thought other things, like kids think, like, I'm going to be an astronaut, I'm going to be a doctor, you know, things that, you know, you're in the box of college, you don't really know who you're going to be. And then it really wasn't until The Voice, which, like I said, just kind of happened. My dad knew the musical director on the show, uh-huh. Went to his house, sung for him. He's like, "Yeah, I can get you on
the
show."
He's like, "I heard my son sing the Carrie Underwood note." He can sing. Yes.
And when I was on the show, you know, the show was cool, but it was the stuff behind the scenes where you're working with all the different singers and artists.
Mm.
And that's where I really felt myself like, "Oh, I really fit in here. And I belong here and I want to be here." And that's kind of what established, yeah, I'm gonna do music.
Did you sing in high school? Or are you in the chorus?
I was in choir one year. Uh-huh. I really didn't like it that much. Yeah.
Really?
I don't know. Maybe it's because...
Have you gone back to talk to your choir teacher?
No, once. Yeah.
I'm sure your choir teacher talks about you. "Oh, Jack Cassidy was in my class." I guarantee you.
He says it, even though we didn't have the best relationship.
It's okay. You do now. But he's a big fan of yours. Yeah, I bet.
People come out of the woodwork.
But
that's how it happened. Yeah, I was the guy in high school that was very unashamed to sing and share my voice.
Mm.
I mean, my senior year, I would have two classes where they would, every Friday, "We're not having class today. We're going out to the amphitheater because Jack brought his keyboard and we're going to just listen to him perform."
Nice. Okay.
That was cool. The whole school knew that I was, you know, one of the only singers in that school. It was a way more sports-oriented school, so I was kind of different being the artist type.
Yeah, I get it.
But yeah, it became like a career path, something I wanted to own, especially when the recovery and the drug stuff and Jesus saving me happened. That's really when songwriting sparked, and I went, "Oh my gosh, I have something to talk about.
Mm.
I have something really I need to share, and I'm going to share it through this gift that God has placed inside of me."
How did it feel coming out and telling your story?
I mean, people tell me all the time, like, "Thank you for your bravery. Thank you for all these things." But it's, which, thank you, and I'm glad I can be that. But it's just, that's just how I am.
Mm-hmm.
I can't put on a mask. It's just, it's not in my nature.
Was there ever a time you thought, I can't tell people what I was going through, or I'll be judged, or any of that?
Maybe when I was on The Voice, even though the, you know, cocaine stuff hadn't happened yet, it was I was probably a little more skeptical then. Mm. You know, I wanted to, it was my first introduction to the public, and I was like, I don't want to be judged. I don't want to be this. I want mm-hmm. people to like me. And then I just kind of let all that go. Mm. And it was just like, if you like me or not, I'm just going to speak what I believe in and what I know can help people that want to listen.
Yeah. How's your relationship with your parents today?
It's great.
Yeah. Is your dad proud of you?
Like no other.
I bet you.
Like no other.
Yeah.
And he's always been my biggest supporter, my biggest fan. And he's couldn't have asked for a better dad.
Yeah.
And my mom as well. She's my dad was just the guy that kind of taught me music and singing. So
he's
very proud, very proud.
Do you guys ever sing songs together as a family?
All the time.
I love it.
And when I, you know, make new friends and bring them over, they're just kind of like baffled and in awe of it. And like, cause we, you know, we're professionals. We know how to sing. And,
mm-hmm.
and when we're doing, you know, father and son, full blown harmonies and
so
everything.
When you guys are singing happy birthday to people, it's like a legit happy birthday.
In my family, it's wild. When there's family gatherings, there are 5-part harmonies among all my uncles that sing. It's quite an experience for a happy birthday.
I love it. Well, excellent. Well, I know, so I have been waiting to hear Run at the Giant, and we've got a keyboard here.
We do. It's never too far from me.
Would you like to play Run at the Giant for the audience?
I would love to.
Excellent. Yeah. We would love to hear this.
Doc sleeps like a monster under my bed. Fear dances round and round. Every single time I thought I was dead, you were with me in the valley. You were with me. Oh, you're with me in the fire. You're strong and never tired. Strong enough to hide. I will run at the giant.
What advice would you give to someone who
is facing a Goliath? Someone that is facing a giant in their own life and they don't know where to go. They don't know what to do and they're trapped.
Yeah. For me, definitely the first step is recognize that it's a giant.
Yeah.
Don't see the things that we've been giving ourselves to for comfort, for self-medication. Expose it for what it is. It's only going to, you know, ruin your life. It's only going to take you away from the things that you love, and it's only going to, you know, lead to destruction in the end. So first, recognize that to go, even though I'm drawn to this right now, I really don't want that. So first, and then be humble enough in the first step of the AA program to say, I need help, and I'm an alcoholic, or I'm an addict, and I all that stuff. And then in my case, I'd say you have to turn it over to God, and you have to start to pray to something. If you weren't raised in church, or you weren't raised with faith, seek that out. Ask people that have been through the same things as you. Ask people how they did it. And for me, it was relying on the strength of God and knowing that for me, in Christ is just so much better. It's so much better than any high I could ever get elsewhere. It's the high of just living and being and seeing the joy of life all around you and connecting to the things that God has put in this world that are good and that are worth being connected to. And that makes me not want to ever go back to those things that disconnect me, because I'm so in love with what I have now and what I've found in Christ and how He's restored my relationships and my purpose for being here.
Jack, you are such an inspiration. Everything that you do, everything that you are, everything that you say, and I'm grateful that you have the story that you're willing to share and a voice to share it. The impact that you will have in this world, you were given this story for a reason.
Amen.
And I've already seen it, and it will just continue to snowball. So where can people find you? You are all over, so where can people find you and follow you and all of the things?
Yeah, my Instagram is Jack Cassidy Music. That's where you'll see most of, you know, what's up and coming and what's happening. Same thing on Facebook, just Jack Cassidy. You'll see my little face pop up, and it's good. You can find me on YouTube. That's where my music videos are mainly getting the attention, and you can see
definitely
those.
Pandora. I will speak to Pandora. You are all over Jen Sugarmeyer's Pandora station, that is for sure.
But it's released on all platforms. Yeah. Apple, Spotify, Pandora, so
yeah,
check that out. And you know, I only have two songs out right now, and they're doing really good. And
you talked about a third, so
a third is
we're
coming,
expecting the third. Okay.
And I am ridiculously excited about it.
Yeah,
it's literally the song I wrote at my year mark of being clean.
Wow.
About the night that Jesus saved my life.
Wow.
And it's the most personal song to me. So.
Yeah. Do you play local in Nashville?
I do. I'm branching out now to, you know, reach out to different places. But a place I've played at weekly is a place called Puckett's in Leaper's Fork.
Okay.
And almost every Thursday night I'm there at open mic night. And then every other month or so I play a show there either on a Friday night or Saturday night and do my full set. So.
Oh. Sometimes I go to karaoke with my friends. I don't know if I could go to open mic night. That's Jack Cassidy walks in. That's exciting.
It's fun.
That's
really
exciting.
Fun.
I love that.
And a lot of different stars come in. I got to sing with Rag and Bone Man one night. He sings Human.
Yeah.
And we did Let It Be by the Beatles, and a lot of different people come through there, and it's a fun time.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, thank you so much for your time, and
we
look forward to seeing your journey and everything that's coming up in the future. You have such a bright future, and you know, you are very young still, and
22.
That's exciting. So
look a little older, just even not shaved, but if the
it's
beard
the wisdom.
It's the wisdom. It's the 80-year-old in me. Yeah.
It's the wisdom. So thank you so much for sharing your story, and thank you everyone for tuning in. This is Jen Sugarmeyer and Jack Cassidy bringing you stories of strength and hope. We'll see you next time.